Sharon Green Middleton from the 6th District, Councilman Mark Conway, 4th District, and Chair of the Public Safety and Government Operations Committee, Councilman Antonio Glover, 13th District, Councilman Isaac Yitzi Schleifer, 5th District, and Chair of the Rules and Legislative Oversight Committee, Councilman Robert Stokes, 12th District, Chair of the Education, Youth, and Workforce Committee, Pastor Alvin Gwynn from Historic Leadenhall Baptist Church. We're here today to talk about public safety, specifically the state of public safety in our city at this time is unacceptable. We are currently on track for over 350 homicides this year. As of April 30th, for the first time in the history of the city of Baltimore, we have exceeded over 100 homicides, specifically 112 homicides. As many as 17% of our entire City Watch camera portfolio is currently down. In the last week alone, we have had a number of tragic incidents leading up to the 12th student at Baltimore City Public Schools being killed this year as a result of homicide. We had a 17-year-old young man who was killed after celebrating his junior prom. We had 60 gunshots fired in the middle of a residential neighborhood in the middle of the day. And we had a pregnant woman and her fiance murdered, and her baby, who was delivered prematurely, fighting for its life, not to mention the one-year-old child that they have. In short, the communities and the people that we represent expect a sense of urgency around this issue. With upcoming budget hearings this year, we intend to demonstrate that sense of urgency around this issue. Specifically, we have sent out letters to the Baltimore Police Department, the State's Attorney's Office of Baltimore City, and the Mayor's Office of Neighborhood and Safety Engagement. The letter to the Baltimore Police Department outlines a request for a short-term crime plan to be delivered to this committee by no later than June 3rd in anticipation of their hearing on June 7th. It outlines a number of different components to increase presence and visibility in the communities of our city. The letter to Monsey, or the Mayor's Office of Neighborhood and Safety Engagement, outlines background on the lack of demonstrable progress around the group violence reduction strategy, the severe outages of City Watch cameras, and the unprecedented level of funding which has been committed to that agency, specifically $50,300,000, of which it was reported to the council only $75,000 has been expended to date. And finally, the letter to the State's Attorney's Office of Baltimore City deals with staffing for prosecutorial action, specifically for supervisors and line ASAs, as well as the appropriate levels of staffing for victim services. Before I pass it over to Council President or Council Vice President Middleton, let me say that I unequivocally agree with the direction that the mayor is taking around addressing the root causes of violence in our city. And those root causes specifically revolve around inadequate K through 12 public education and lack of economic opportunity. Those are the reasons that we have crime in this city. And I don't think there is anyone on the council that disagrees with attacking those issues with a sense of urgency. But we also have to address the issue of crime that is plaguing our community right now. I want to be very clear about that. With that, I'm going to pass it off to Council Vice President Sharon Green Middleton, and then we'll take questions.
Thank you, Councilman Costello. And I agree with everything that Chair Costello has mentioned. And, you know, we're approaching our budget season, and we're very serious this year. All of us have been experiencing an influx of phone calls. We have all of us have concentrated areas that go all the way back to the 60s and 70s. And I can just give, you know, some specific areas. The incident that happened at Borman, right one block away is the Towanda Rec Center and the 4200 block of Towanda, which is it's a very clean, excellent block, full with seniors, that heard that gunfire. I have an area on Norfolk Avenue, another area that has been a haven of gangs and crime since the 70s. A senior calls my office every other day on that block from gang members, 30, lined up. I have an area in Park Heights near Lucille Park. Loads of activity. People are calling our offices, crying out, and it's time that the police department sit down and give us an immediate plan. It's the responsibility of the police department. Safety is our number one priority in this city. So yes, this is just a professional cry out that we need immediate help. We agree with the plans that are in place, but we need something now that's going to help us be from now, at least through September, something that is the responsibility of the Baltimore City Police Department and the mayor and our administration. So please answer our calls of plea at this time.
Thank you, Madam Vice President. There are copies of the letters on that table there. We're happy to take questions.
Specific to the state's attorney's office, the lack of lying prosecutors that you guys have mentioned, how influential do you think that is to the crime fight or the lack of crime fight?
Well, look, the only agency that can impact things immediately is the Baltimore Police Department. That being said, we understand the depth and the complexity of this issue, and it would be irresponsible of us to only say it's the police department that's responsible. Part of the exercise we go through during budget hearings is to review progress during the current fiscal year, which is 22, and what the proposed plans are for fiscal year 23. We view that the staffing levels at the state's attorney's office are something that are critically important. We need to make sure that we have the appropriate number of supervisors and line ASAs in order to prosecute the cases that BPD is bringing to the table. So we think that's part of the discussion and part of the larger discussion, but the focus right now is on that short-term crime plan and stopping the bleeding.
Did you invite the mayor and the commissioner through? Did they know that you guys were having this conference?
They are aware.
Did you invite them?
No, we did not. Start with the VP.
The first thing that comes to my mind, we need foot patrol in these areas. We need cars riding this area, not 3 days after or a week after. We need consistency, and that's not happening now. This is what we're hearing from our constituents. We don't see people riding in the cars anymore. We need help now.
Justin, it's a great question that I'm going to bring up Councilman Schleifer after. There are a number of opportunities to have a more visible presence in our communities. Many of those things are outlined as components of the short-term crime plan that we're requesting, specifically the utilization of overtime spending, ramping up civilianization efforts, which, as you're aware, is something this council has been talking about for years, and making formal requests of our federal and state law enforcement partners to ensure that they're giving us the resources we need, because we are currently not in control of this situation, so we do need that support. Councilman Schleifer.
Yeah, so to answer that question, I mean, there's two critical things that I've been saying for a couple of years now that needs to be done, and those are the two components that actually solve crimes in the city. This situation isn't going to change unless cases are cleared, unless these crimes are solved, and so we know the detective units, they work extremely hard. We have some of the best detectives in the country, but their caseload is way too high. It's far beyond the national average. And so we need more detectives working these cases so that more cases are getting solved. In addition to that, we know we have a great crime lab as well. The crime lab also, we know there's tons of evidence that doesn't get processed and doesn't get processed in a reasonable amount of time. And so if we had the resources just to those two components, you would see an instant reduction of the same violent repeat offenders continuously committing the same violent crimes.
It seems like there's these dual discussions of sort of either reducing police spending so that money can be spent on the root cause things, but also I hear you saying we
want more visibility and patrol, that means more patrol. We want more detectives, that means more detectives. We've staffed up the internal affairs, more detectives there, more resources for the crime lab. It sounds like people are saying there's these considerations that are inherently in conflict with each other.
Well, I can respond for myself, and that's, I don't think that we should be reducing it. I think we need to be increasing it. I think we need more detectives, more members of the crime lab, and I've been pretty consistent in saying that.
And do the council members have any reaction to the announcement yesterday about officers no longer going out to take down emergency reports? Do you think that's a good move? Are you concerned about less contact with the public that way?
Look, this is not about the mayor's announcement yesterday.
I just want to get the word.
Yeah, absolutely. But that policy is directly in conflict with what we're all talking about. We're talking about presence and visibility in the community, and that, you know, again, but that's not what this announcement is about. This precedes that announcement. This is about increasing that presence and visibility. So one of the things that we've asked for in that letter under the components that should be included in a short-term crime plan is a plan to move every BPD officer that is sworn, which means if you're sworn, that means you have a badge, you have a firearm, and you can effect an arrest in the state of Maryland. We are asking them to put as many of those individuals as humanly possible in our communities right now. That's been a multi-year discussion that we've been having with the police department about how do we ramp up those civilianization efforts, because right now we have individuals in the department that are working jobs that could be worked by civilians. So essentially we have a limited number of sworn officers, right? And that shortage does exist in many of our sister jurisdictions, not only in Maryland, but in major cities throughout the United States. The bottom line though, we cannot afford to have sworn officers performing a civilian function right now with what is going on in our city.
I didn't quite catch the number of cameras that are out. Could you repeat that? And did you give any indication if that's more than usual and why?
So we have a little over 800 cameras in the City Watch portfolio. My understanding is that about 755 of those are managed by the Mayor's Office of Neighborhood and Safety Engagement, and approximately between 17% and 18% of those cameras are out. At any given time. There's a variety of reasons why those cameras may be out. I think that we certainly understand that there are technical challenges along the way, but 17% to 18%, which is approximately 130 cameras, is not an acceptable rate of outage to have in the city. Our goal should be 100% uptime, not 85%, not 83%, not 90%.
I just want to add, our constituency, they want to see our police department. They want to see them walking. They want that partnership. We go to meetings, and it's the first thing that they're always talking about. Where is our police officer? They want to have that communication, whether they're in their car or walking. They want that one-on-one. They're begging for it. And that's what we are just trying to offer and get our message. And because we're going through our budget, getting ready to start our budget season, we're giving the police department time to get something together for us. This is serious. The people, our constituency out there, they don't see the things that we try to work on through letter writing and meetings. They want to see our police, we want to see our police, and we just want it to happen as soon as possible.
We know how hard our officers work in the city, and I have reached out and talked about bringing in the state troopers to help patrol, because a lot of times in some districts, particularly Eastern District, they only have 14 police that cover a whole district. How can you cover a whole district? Like, it's virtually impossible. That's why I'm reaching out and the rest of the council people to ask the state, the governor, to give us some more resources, because the police can't do this by themselves. It's out of control. They shoot during the daytime, they shoot at night. They killed a young lady who was pregnant in my district. They killed a young man who was celebrating his prom. I mean, I got one district, one community in my district. They've been shooting, killing people for over 40 years. They're still shooting and killing people. This city needs some help. This police department needs some help. And again, I will be reaching out asking for the governor, to our legislators, to talk to our state troopers so they can help patrol some of these neighborhoods. Again, when you only have 14 police in one district, that's awful.
And the bullying has increased. They're starting to call us so we can get the message across. We would have an influx of community leaders here in some of these concentrated areas, but they are frightened. They are frightened, but they do meet at their associations and talk about it. They talk with us on the phones. We're the extension and the vessel that's getting this extra information out to our police department.
And let me bring it full circle on the request for additional resources. That is outlined specifically as one of the components of the short-term crime plan that we are requesting to be submitted to the committee by no later than June 3rd. We can stand up here and scream and cry and complain and curse and so on and so forth about the need for more resources. The request formally needs to come from the executive branch. That request needs to come from the executive branch. The governor, the superintendent of the state police, is not going to listen to the Baltimore City Council. Mm-hmm. They're not going to. That request must formally come from the executive branch. And that's what we are asking as one of the components of that crime plan.
The mayor has spoken in opposition of sharing the crime plan to the public. Do you guys think that if you shared that crime plan, are you behind the stance that it shouldn't be made known to the public about the crime plan because criminals would know, you know, what their tactics are? Are you asking to share his tactics, or are you asking what the framework is?
So it's really the framework. Look, I will speak for myself. I had a security clearance when I worked for the federal government. I have never divulged for official use only information in nearly eight years on this council. If the mayor or the police commissioner want to share sensitive information with us in the appropriate setting in a closed non-public briefing with a commitment that we will not share that information, I am certain that I can speak for every council member standing up here with me that we are more than happy to have that conversation. The things that we are asking for in that letter are not intelligence specific or operational specific. We are specifically asking for more resources and how to ramp up presence and visibility to stop the short-term bleeding. I think there is certainly a time and a place for a sensitive discussion around certain intelligence and other criminal activities. We are not, I want to be crystal clear, we are not suggesting having that conversation in a public setting, because that is inappropriate and irresponsible.
Can you turn this out of this council is going to be looking at cuts from the police budget? Would you be advocating for increases then?
It's too early to say what the committee is going to do. We have four of the seven committee members here today, Council Vice President Middleton, Councilman Stokes, and Councilman Schleifer. What I would say is right now, our expectation is that we have a very detailed short-term crime plan as we've laid out in the letter. And we look forward to reviewing that in a great deal, excruciating level of detail during the hearing. And then we will certainly go from there, but I think it's too early to say what that looks like.
What are you prepared to do? You set a deadline for them to provide the plan. What are you prepared to do if they do not comply?
We'll cross that bridge when it comes. We have found Mayor Scott to be a partner to the council. And the expectation is that continues. So I am confident, and I think we are all confident, that Mayor Scott is going to direct the police commissioner to comply with our request. And we look forward to reviewing that once it's submitted. In the meantime, certainly available to the mayor, his senior staff, as well as the police commissioner and his senior staff to discuss the specifics of exactly what we're looking for. Ad nauseum.
So this is a public question.
Ad nauseum, we've had these conversations. Thank you, everyone. Someone's got a cell phone down there. Don't know whose it is. Those are expensive.